everybody.
Hey, how are you? Hi.
Well, thank you for braving the elements to come out here tonight. You know, people are having a lot of time, taking time for people to get back into the groove of things after COVID. Broadway performances are down 25%. People are slowly getting back to the theaters. I think we don't understand, except in retrospect, how much change COVID has caused in this country. So welcome back. We're going to get this place filled up again, just like we did pre-COVID. We're working on that. In the meantime, we got some wonderful music for you. And let me start by thanking the library, who has been hosting this program for, lo, these many years, 27 in point of fact, 27 and counting. That would be Alice and Max and Chuck and Sandra. They've been wonderful. They are supportive, and I couldn't ask for better partners with whom to do this labor of love. Between the wars, that is World War I and World War II, if you went to Broadway, you were more likely than not to see a revue. If you went to Broadway in the 30s and 40, late 30s and 40s, they started to do very silly book shows. The Irving Berlin, Gershwin shows were often kind of silly things. And then in the 50s and 60s and 70s, kind of my era, which I grew up with and loved, the book shows really became wonderful. At that point, books became even more serious. So often, that's when I stopped calling it musical comedy, and I called it musical theater, because a lot of these things weren't inexorable, which I love, had a murder, a suicide, and a death. So, hello. So, but in the 20s, there weren't book shows much. They were really reviews. And in many ways, if you think about that, that was really an outgrowth of vaudeville. Vaudeville was nothing but reviews, right? Vaudeville had skits and comedy shows and juggling acts and singers and comedians. And that was vaudeville. That's what it was. In fact, the closest thing we have left to vaudeville in the United States today is cruise ships. You can go on cruise ships and see all the kinds of acts that had appeared on vaudeville over 100 years ago. Well, the Broadway Review was nothing more than a very high-quality production outgrowth of vaudeville, and that's what you had in Broadway in the 20s. Between 1920 and 1929, there were, count them, 150 reviews on Broadway in New York City. That, for those of you who have trouble with arithmetic, is 15 a year. And that's, again, you had the songs and dances and skits, production numbers, but you had much more sophisticated production value, better lighting, better costumes than you had in vaudeville, and that's why it was Broadway. That's a format, the reviews, gave songwriters a great opportunity to get their songs going, because instead of having one person like George Gershwin or Julie Stein or Irving Berlin write all the songs for a show, you could propose a song for a review, which was disparate, right? And you could have that song put in there. So lots and lots of different songwriters were represented in reviews. So in many ways, the review, especially in the 20s, was a repository for a great body of American music. So that's how it worked. By the way, in those days, people that you knew who later wrote book shows did write a lot of reviews. George Gershwin wrote reviews. Rodgers and Hart wrote reviews. DeSilva, Brown, and Henderson wrote reviews. As a matter of fact, the very first Rodgers and Hart hit in 1925 was a song called Manhattan. We'll have Manhattan, the Bronx and Staten Island too, that one. We'll have fun going to the zoo. That was from a review called the Garrick Gaieties in 1925. Now, you are familiar, whether you know it or not. Yes, you know it. You're familiar with it, and you do know it. Because we have smart people in this room. You heard about some of these famous reviews. The most famous of them all were the Ziegfeld Follies. That was a man who just nothing but reviews, Ziegfeld, George Ziegfeld. There were the box office reviews. That was particularly interesting because the box office was the name of a theater. Irving Berlin was a very smart man in addition to being a great writer and lyricist, and he actually built his own theater, which is still in New York, called the Music Box Theater. And he did that primarily to run reviews, which were called the Music Box Reviews. You can go to New York right now and you can go to that theater because it's still beautiful, and it's still there. George White's Scandals was another impresario, George White, who did reviews. Earl Carroll's Vanities was another man, Earl Carroll, who did reviews. And the Garrick himself, Mr. Garrick, Garrick Gates, from which we get Manhattan. A subset of all this, by the way, was people were doing a lot of black reviews, too. Because in those days, black people were very talented, and white people loved to come to see black people do things. That's why they went to Harlem. Harlem was a place where black people performed, and white people were in the audience. Cotton Club, Apollo, all of that. The first one of these, of any great note, was called The Blackbirds of 1928. And that was a show, by the way, that introduced Bojangles. That was in a black review called Blackbirds. And another one in 1931 was called Hot Chocolates. Now, the song you're about to hear first tonight is from a review, maybe one of the most important reviews that ever came along, which was called Bandwagon. Bandwagon was the first review done toward the end of the 20s. It was the first review that was more literate. It was still a review, but it had a book by none other than George S. Kaufman, the man who came to dinner, that George S. Kaufman. He wrote that review with Howard and Dietz, who wrote the music in the late 1920s. And it became a hallmark, because at that time, it was more literate, it was more sophisticated, it was more interesting in a lot of different ways. So Bandwagon has become like a hallmark for really wonderful reviews. And the song you're about to hear, and you probably know who's going to be singing it, was from The Bandwagon in 1931. The song is called Dancing in the Dark. And by the way, a couple of interesting things about this show. In this show, Bandwagon, on Broadway in 1931, was the first time, or the last time, that Fred Astaire ever danced on a Broadway stage with his sister Adele. It was after this show in 1931 that Fred Astaire went off to dance with many, many other wonderful people. It was the first time in history that Broadway had a revolving stage, but it didn't have a revolving stage. It had two revolving stages. That had never happened before. That was a revolution in Broadway theater. And I would say, I have something I made up. I think I made it up. Called the consensus of the cognoscenti. The consensus of the cognoscenti. I love this concept because I'll tell you what it is. You can have legitimately any opinion you want about anything. You can say Frank Sinatra is the best singer, he's not the best, whatever, you know. But in any field of endeavor, there's a group of people who are highly knowledgeable, people who are really above like the common man and woman, and they can have a consensus among themselves. So that, for example, the cognoscenti will always tell you that the greatest singer that ever lived was Frank Sinatra. Now, you can argue with that, but I'm just saying, if you go to jazz musicians and composers and other people in the music business, the consensus of those people always will be that Frank Sinatra was the best singer that ever lived in popular music. I happen to agree with that, as you probably know. The consensus of the cognoscenti was that Bandwagon was the greatest review that ever happened, and that happened almost 100 years ago. Now, Dancing in the Dark was not originally in that review. What happened, you know, because often when you're developing a Broadway show, hi, Jim. You're developing a Broadway show, you need a song here, you don't need a song here, whatever. So Dancing in the Dark was actually put into this show very late in the process. Then, when Dancing in the Dark was introduced in that show in 1931, Bing Crosby, no less, sang the song and had a big hit record with it, went to number three in the charts in 1931. And then, in 1941, interesting enough, 10 years later, Artie Shaw recorded that record and became one of eight gold records that Artie Shaw ever made. Then, in 1953, interesting little sidelight, they did a movie of The Bandwagon. A little later. It was very unlike the Broadway show, but they did this movie. And in this movie, Fred Astaire and Sid Charisse danced to Dancing in the Dark in Central Park. It was the first time that Fred Astaire ever danced with Sid Charisse. So that in the Broadway show of Bandwagon, it was the last time he danced with his sister Adele, and in the movie Bandwagon in 1953, it was the first time he ever danced with Sid Charisse. What happened with Dancing in the Dark is the producers wanted a what they called a dark song. They wanted a song that was mysterious in some way. It had to be a love song, but they didn't want, like, it's spring and it's June and I love you and I moon. Or it's moon, June. No, they wanted something a little bit subversive. And this is when Schwartz and Deese came up with Dancing in the Dark. They did another movie, a bandwagon, by the way, in 1949, called Dancing in the Dark, which is not memorable at all. So actually, this bandwagon and then two movies. So you can do a lot of different things when you have really good material. The bandwagon movie in 1953, which was great, although not particularly aligned with the original show, became number 17 on the AFI, American Film Institute, list of the greatest films of all time. That's a pretty good number when you're up against Casablanca and The Godfather, right? When they did the film in 1953, they added a song to it called That's Entertainment. Isn't that interesting? That's Entertainment was not done for, what's going on out there? It was not going for the original bandwagon. It was done for the movie in 1953. And that joined Hooray for Hollywood, written by Johnny Mercer, and There's No Business Like Show Business, written by Irving Berlin, as one of the three great anthems of show business. That's Entertainment, Hooray for Hollywood, There's No Business Like Show Business. By the way, Bruce Springsteen has a record called Dancing in the Dark. That has nothing to do with our Dancing in the Dark, because as you know, because I've told you before, you cannot copyright a title. There are 750 songs by the title of I Love You in the ASCAP catalog. So now I want to tell you a little bit about a bandwagon because we like trivia here. So bandwagon was originally a wagon that carried the band, right? So if you had a circus going into town, then the band would get on the bandwagon and they'd play music, so you kind of follow the bandwagon into where the circus was. That was the bandwagon. Well, it turns out that it was later that when Zachary Taylor was running for president, he used that word, people got on the bandwagon. So it might have been 1858, maybe some. Anybody know when he ran? Let's say it was 1858 for the sake of well-being. You can go Google it. Anyway, he was about to use that as a metaphor. It was a bandwagon, meaning you can jump on this bandwagon to become, you know, more politically active. So it has a nice metaphorical history. 1848, I got it written down. 1848. What happened was there was a guy named Dan Rice who was the clown in this circus. And Zachary Taylor was running for office. And he said, why don't you get on the bandwagon? Well, you can wave to everybody and maybe pick up a few votes. So he did. So Taylor became popular. So everybody said, well, this guy's really popular. We should get on the bandwagon. See what happened? And now all this time later, we talk about bandwagon. So by 1900, everybody was using it, most notably in 1900, William Jennings Bryan. And then for a while, it became negative. So if you were like not a really thinking person, you're just jumping on the bandwagon, which is to say you're not thinking for yourself, which is what that is, by the way. Jumping on the bandwagon is, by definition, not thinking for yourself, right? But then it became, you know, a big deal, field of inquiry. So, you know, I'm interested in persuasion and speech and all that kind of stuff. And there, the bandwagon effect is often called the group think, or herd behavior, or the snowball effect. You've heard that. They're all synonyms for the bandwagon. And it's a very interesting phenomenon, right? Fashion trends, politics, ideas, all that kind of stuff that can be a bandwagon. But we have a more frivolous bandwagon, which is the original bandwagon that carried the band and music, but I thought a little bit of digression never hurt anybody. Dancing in the Dark from Bandwagon, the show, and the actual wagon, was written by Arthur Schwartz, who was born in Brooklyn in 1900, and he died in New York City. I tell you that because most of these guys were born in the East and died out here one way or the other. He was a wonderful songwriter. He wrote That's Entertainment, of course. He wrote a wonderful song called You and the Night and the Music, and then By Myself, he wrote. And then notice By Myself and You and the Night and the Music all have in common a little bit of ephemeral aspect to them. He also, by the way, produced the very first, there were two biopics of Cole Porter. First one was fairly recent, but the original one is called Night and Day. It was 1946. And he produced that. And what one of the interesting things about that movie, it was there's no reference at all in that movie to Cole Porter's homosexuality. The most recent movie that was done within the last 10 or 12 years was almost all about his homosexuality. So that's how things have changed. You may know that Arthur Schwartz, the great songwriter you're about to hear, had a son named Jonathan Schwartz, who made a living talking about the Great American Songbook. He was on WNEW in New York for a long time, then on WNYC in New York, and then satellite radio, XM Sirius satellite radio. And I became frustrated after a while, because every time I turned around, there's Jonathan Schwartz. And I said, come there and ask me. But it's never worked. And then he got caught up in the Me Too movement, as so many did in those days. And he has been. I would say, ungraciously put out the pasture for whatever reason. I want to tell you a story. Schwartz wrote a song called I Guess I'll Have to Change My Plan. You know that song? I guess I'll have to change my plan. I should have realized there'd be another man. Why did I give myself completely before the big affair began? That one? Arthur Schwartz and Larry Hart, two geniuses, young teenagers, early 20s, were counselors at a camp in upstate New York in 1924. They were asked to write a song about the camp. And these two guys, I think, Arthur Schwartz and Larry Hart, they were camp counselors, and this is the song that they write. And just get a load, and you'll recognize the melody, right? But get a load of this lyric that Larry Hart wrote when he was 21 years old about the camp. And you'll know the melody. I guess I have to change my plan. I love to lie awake in bed. Right after taps, I pull the flaps above my head and watch the moonlight on my pillow. Oh, what a light those moonbeams shed. I feel so happy I could cry. And tears are born right in the corner of my eye. To be at home with Ma was never like this. I could live forever like this. I love to lie awake a while and go to sleep with a smile. How good is that? How good is that? I'm not talking about my singing. No, I'm talking about Larry Hart's lyric. It's a wonderful little camp song, right? I mean, this is like really genius. Yeah, perfect rhyme structure. The notes match the lyric. It's perfect. Perfect. 7 years later, Schwartz is doing a show, and he brings out that melody, and he loves the melody. But obviously, those lyrics don't translate much. It's not exactly a love song or anything like that. So he goes to Larry Hart, who completely forgot about those lyrics, of course. By that time, he was Rodgers and Hart. And he said, look, I want to dust off that melody and do something with it. And I said, sure, of course. What do I care? You know, no big deal to me. This guy was about to have 150 gold records in 20 years. You know, he could be magnanimous. And so they write together, Schwartz and Deese, I guess I'll have to change my plan. And then that became like a huge hit. And one of the lines in that song is, why did I buy those blue pajamas before that big affair began? And that became known as the Blue Pajama Song, and it was very, 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 very popular. Howard Deese, Arthur Schwartz's partner, was born in New York City in 1896, but he only worked until 1965, which wasn't very long at all, because he had Parkinson's disease, and he wasn't able to work. So he didn't write too much, but he actually became the publicity director for MGM and a whole other line of work still in show business, and you will find this interesting, I think, he created the Lion logo. It was Arthur Schwartz, Howard Deese, who wrote the lyrics for the song you're about to hear, who came up with the idea of using the lion as the logo for MGM. He was a genius, and he said, like Sammy Kahn, that he could write anything. Give me two words, he said, and I'll write any piece of poetry you want. So somebody said, okay, I'll give you two words, Charisse, as in Sid Charisse, and mantle. Those are the two words. Here's what he comes up with. Sid Charisse, up there on the mantelpiece, you gave us a shock there. There should be a clock there. That's Howard Deese. You can clap for Howard Deese if you want to. They're very terrific. Or you don't have to. Okay. This song Dancing in the Dark by the man himself, Frank Sinatra, was from Frank Sinatra's most successful album ever, and he had a lot of successful albums. It was called Come Dance With Me. Interestingly enough, that was a sequel album. The first album, which was very successful, was called Come Fly With Me, worked so well that he did a sequel to that called Come Dance With Me. Come Dance With Me was even more successful than Come Fly With Me. This was in 1959. Listen to this. The album from which the song you're about to hear comes was on the Billboard charts for 2.5 years. 150 weeks. It was in the top 10 for 58 weeks. 29 of those weeks were in 1959, and 29 of those weeks were in 1960. And the liner notes were Vocals That Dance. In 1960, Come Fly With Me, Come Dance With Me won Album of the Year Grammy, Best Vocal for a Male Grammy, and Best Arrangement, Billy May. It was an absolute tour de force. And I think you will love what you're about to hear. And at that point, you know the thing you do in college, you sit around, you could have ideas before you ever, there were the real world, where you sit around, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? Remember all that stuff? Once you get into the working world, you can't have time to do that anymore. Well, the new question was, is Frank Sinatra a jazz singer? You know, that's one of the great imponderables of the world. Because I don't know what a jazz singer is. A lot of people, well, it's just scat, you know. They call Elvis Presley a jazz singer. Well, I don't know why you'd say Elvis Presley is a jazz singer and Frank Sinatra is not a jazz singer. I don't quite understand that. A lot of people think they're jazz singers if they're singing with Count Basie. The fact that you're in the Basie band makes you a jazz singer. But in any event, I will say this about Frank. There were two big polls going on in the 50s and 60s and 70s. One was the Playboy poll, which was very, very sophisticated and well-respected. And the other was Downbeat. And Downbeat was the big jazz magazine that all the jazzers. Frank Sinatra from 52 to 65 got Best Male Vocalist in both of those every year. So I say to you, Frank Sinatra was a jazz singer. And I'm not part of the consensus. Dancing in the Dark, the lyric is really wonderful, a lot of female rhymes in there. Dancing in the dark till the tune ends, we're dancing in the dark and it soon ends. We're waltzing in the wonder of why we're here, time hurries by, we're here and we're gone. See, they wanted a mystical ephemeral song, a little bit dark, a little bit unusual, they got it. And then looking for the light of a new love to brighten up the night, I have you love and we can face the music together. And then a complete change. What though love is old, what though song is old, through them we can be young. Hear this heart of mine wailing all the time. Dear one, tell me that we're one. Very, very interesting bridge when he goes into what though love is old, what though song is old. This is a tour de force. Billy May arrangement. At the beginning, you'll hear kind of a dance simulation in this, and you'll hear Dancing in the Dark by Frank, and then you'll hear a swoop. See, a swoop is a dance feeling, see, and then till the tune ends, and another swoop, that kind of thing. There's simulated dancing throughout this. Then there's a lot of restraint in the instrumental bridge. What I love about these guys like Billy May, who could cook and blast you out the back of the room, he could also restrain, right? Just a touch, just a little bit of a feeling of jazz and swing and rhythm without feeling it has to be oppressive all the time. One of the things that's interesting to me about Sinatra, he's always fun. You know, the important thing about Sinatra is emotion, right? He conveys the emotion of a song. That's what art is really all about. But he also had fun all the time. So, Looking for the Light. After the instrumental bridge and Sinatra comes back to sing Looking for the Light, notice how he does it. He's just playing around. The second time he sings, okay, so you go through it, then there's an instrumental bridge, and I don't want you to miss this, and then he comes back looking for the light. He just makes it fun. He makes it exciting. He makes it dynamic. Why did he do that? I don't know. He did it instinctively. Everything creative, I'm beginning to believe, is instinctive. But just the way he did that is absolutely wonderful. The other thing to notice, Sinatra grew up in the big band era, right? And I think deep down, he wanted to be a big band guy. He wanted to be a sideman. He wanted to be like Conrad Gozzo playing the trumpet, or Rossellino playing the trombone. So that he was, when he was with these bands, these musicians, he loved them. He was exactly where he wanted to be, doing exactly what he wanted to do, and he wanted to be one of them. And he identified with them in that sense. So that created an integration between Frank and these musicians and these arrangements that is really unprecedented. So I think you'll like it all. So here we go, Dancing in the Dark from Bandwagon, 1931. This song, think about this, it's almost 100 years old, and it's as fresh as ever. So here we go, Dancing in the Dark. Oh, and by the way, so we now have visuals up here, and the visuals are not designed to elucidate anything. They're just visuals of things that I have mentioned. So if I've talked about something in the last 20 minutes, person or a place or a thing, vegetable, animal, mineral, any of that, then so you can see it on the screen. So you don't have to go home and Google anything. I'm pre-Googling for you. Okay, so here we go.
Dancing in the dark till the tune ends. We're dancing in the dark, and it soon ends. We're waltzing in the wonder of why we're here.
Yes.
Time hurries by, we're here, and we're gone, looking for the light.
Yeah.
Our new love.
Come on.
I have you, love. We can face the music together, dancing in the dark.
Here comes that great bridge.
What though love is old? What though song is old? Through them we can be young. Heart of mine, well, all the time, dear one, tell me that we're one.
Billy May, restraint.
Lighten up the night. I have you, love, and we can face the music together. Dancing in the dark, dancing in the dark, dancing in the dark.
Yeah. Come on. Oh, yeah. I hope you like that last slide, just in case you didn't know what a mantle was. I don't know if anybody here is not on the mailing list, but if you have not received from the library and from me respectively a snail mail notification of this lecture series and an email notification of it, please let us have your mail in here. I have one for this side, and I have one for this side. I supply the pens, and let us keep in touch, because we love to do just that. I should turn that off so you don't know what's coming next. Yeah. Lullabies are over 1,000 years old. 1,000 years that we know about, people have been singing lovely, soothing, melodic songs to help babies sleep. Can you believe this? lullaby is simple, it's repetitive, and the earliest lullaby we know of came from Turkey in 1072. As long as 1072, they were having a little song to lull people to sleep. They were called balubaloos, balubaloo. Anybody speak Turkish? Balubaloo, not to be confused with wallybaloo. And lullaby is an outgrowth of that word. Probably one of the most famous lullabies ever written was the Brahms lullaby, which Johann Brahms wrote in 1869. George Gershwin wrote a lullaby for string quartet. And we have many things in jazz. We have the lullaby of Birdland, the lullaby of Broadway, and the lullaby of the leaves. So people use, and by the way, that's what happens. You get a musical form like the rag or the blues, then you can make up anything, right? You can say blues, right? So we have the Beverly Hills Blues, or the Route 61 Blues, or the Sugar Blues. You can do that with rag, ghost light rag, any kind of rag. So same with lullaby. Lullaby of the leaves, it could be anything you want it to be, because it's like a musical form. So maybe one of the most famous lullabies was written by George Gershwin, called Summertime and the Living is Easy. Summertime is a lullaby. You look at the lyrics to that song, your daddy's rich and your mama's good looking, so hush little baby, don't you cry. George Gershwin wrote a lullaby for all things for Porgy and Bess. And that lullaby, you know, people don't think about it as a lullaby. And by the way, you know what? This is a complete digression, but I heard somebody saying, you know what? Sometimes people don't understand that less is more, right? So there's a wonderful song called Brother, Can You Spare a Dime, right? It was written by Yip Harburg, Depression song. And that song is perfect, right? I mean, that lyric is perfect. Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? So I'm hearing that song because in the anniversary of that song, they did like 50 versions of it. And one person thought he could improve on the lyric Yip Harburg wrote. Rhetorical question. Can anybody improve on a lyric Yip Harburg wrote? No. So at the end of it, instead of saying, brother, can you spare a dime? He said, brother, can you spare one thin dime? See? Can you see what he? Can you see how he added a word to that masterful lyric, and ended up destroying it, literally destroying it? Right? Less is more. Well, the same thing in summertime. Your daddy's rich, and your mom's good looking. That's genius. We think it's simple, but it's not. One person saying that song said, "Your daddy's filthy rich." And it's the same thing. And I'm thinking. So I hear that, and I'm going back to Yip Harburg, and I say, why do they do this? Because it's not just like adding a word. It's like you completely miss the poignancy, the piquant moment of that lyric. But I digress. But, you know, there's nothing worse than, when you know, Frank Sinatra, as far as I can tell, has never missed a lyric. And it's amazing to me how many singers miss lyrics. In other words, they're really great singers and you can love them, but maybe they're not really that smart. So they see those words on a page and they don't get what the rhyme structure is. They don't get what the lyricist was trying to do. And you can tell that they don't understand what is going on. Elvis Girls does that a lot. You know, she'll sing in a certain way that you know she doesn't quite get what's happening there. So it's one of my little pet peeves. When somebody writes a really great lyric, I like to be sung properly. Rock-a-bye, my baby, to a Dixie melody is a lullaby. Rock-a-bye, my baby, to a Dixie melody is a lullaby. And we're going to hear that very shortly. And that song, I just told you, Dancing in the Dark, was almost 100 years old. This song is over 100 years old. 105, to be exact, because it was written in 1918 by three gentlemen. Gene Schwartz, not to be confused with Archer Schwartz, Sam Lewis, and Joe Young. Massive hit for Al Jolson in the 1920s. Massive hit for Al Jolson. And another big hit for Jerry Lewis, who was not a bad singer in point of fact, in 1956. The song is a standard. Harvey Fierstein, the great Harvey Fierstein, actually sang it to Katie Couric on the last day that she had hosting the Today Show, which was really a great moment. And he sang rock-a-bye, your rock-a-bye Katie with a goodbye melody. That was the last time she appeared on the Today Show. John Schwartz, J-E-A-N, but it's a man, was born in 1878 in Budapest, of all places. He came to New York City, and he actually sold sheet music at Macy's. That's when Macy's was actually a department store. You could buy sheet music there, and that's what he did. And then he became a song plugger for Tin Pan Alley down on 28th Street. And his other famous song was Chinatown, My Chinatown, which was a big Dixieland favorite. Sam Lewis, who was born Sam Levine, which is not to be confused with the actor Sam Levine, who was in the original cast of Guys and Dolls in 1950, wrote a number of songs that you will know and love. For All We Know, This May Only Be a Dream. Has anybody seen My Gal? Remember that one? He wrote that. And then another big hit for Al Jolson, Sitting on Top of the World. And then Just Friends, which is a jazz favorite. Just Friends, Lovers No More. Big, big jazz favorite. The other of this triumvirate is Joe Young, born in 1889. And he wrote a song called You're My Everything, with Harry Warren, the most famous singer that you never heard of, Harry Warren, the great Harry Warren. Joe Young, You're My Everything, wrote You're way beyond belief, and just to make it brief, you're my summer, fall, and spring, my everything. And then on a novelty basis, he wrote a wonderful song called And a Shanty, an Old Shanty Town. And then this one by Tommy Edwards. Anybody remember? I'm going to sit right down and write myself a letter and make believe it came from you. Anyone to sing it? I'm going to write the words, oh so sweet. They're going to knock me off my feet. A lot of kisses are on the bottom. I'll be glad I got them. I'm going to write and say, I hope you're feeling better and close with love the way you do. I want to sit right down and write myself a letter and make believe it came, big face, though I know it's not the same, and make believe it came from you. Give yourself a round of applause, an oldie but goodie, written by Joe Young. Al Jolson, the great Al Jolson, born Asa Jolson, in Lithuania. In 1886, died in 1950, very young. And by the way, here's a little tip for you. There are three Baltic countries, right? Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, right? Three Baltic countries? You have blank expressions on your face. There are three Baltic countries, you know these, right? I figured out how to tell, you look at a map and say, which is which? Here's my little secret. They're in alphabetical order. It's Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. So it's just think alphabetical order, you'll never miss, and you can win all kinds of barbers on that, trust me. And by the way, and I do the same thing with the capitals of North and South Dakota. One is Pierre, one is Bismarck. Alphabetical order. Bismarck, North Dakota, Pierre, South Dakota. That's gratuitous for you right there, folks. So anyway, he was born in Lithuania, which is the last of the three, right? You know that now. That's the one down there. It's below the other two, see? You didn't know that, but now you know it. Okay. He was brash, he was extroverted, and he was melodramatic. And he was wonderful. Very, very influential singer. Had a great influence on Bing Crosby, according to Bing. Had a great influence on Judy Garland. And by 1930, Asa Jolson, Al Jolson, was the most best-paid performer in the United States of America. And he did a lot of shows at the Winter Garden Theater. Winter Garden Theater is still there, up on Broadway, a little north of the main part of Times Square. And a matter of fact, previewing there, or about to load in, is a musical version of Back to the Future, which has been running in London, coming to New York, and that will be at the Winter Garden Theater. So if you ever go to New York and see that show, you'll be looking at the very same stage that Al Jolson had 9 sellout performances. He did 9 sellouts at the Winter Garden Theater in the 20s and 30s. And based on the shows there, he had 80 top 40 records. And it was at the Winter Garden when he first uttered the most famous words ever, "You ain't heard nothing yet." And that's what he'd do, right? He'd do something really big and important. People would applause, oh, bravo, and then he'd say, "You ain't heard nothing yet." He also was famously, maybe most famously, in the first full-length film with sound called The Jazz Singer in 1927. And in 1946, he was the subject of a biopic called The Al Jolson Story, where Larry Parks played Al Jolson, but Al Jolson did a lip sync of the lyrics. One of the issues, which doesn't really bother me, because I am not, I am a consummate non-cancel culture person. I mean, consummate. Because I think art is magnificent, and you have to understand the tenors of the time, and anybody who makes the mistake of judging anything today on what had happened 100 years ago or 50 years ago is just creating trouble. So Al Jolson appeared in blackface. He appeared in blackface. You okay? That's what he did. That's what people did in the 1920s. We wouldn't do that today. We did it in the 1920s. Is he a bad person for appearing in blackface in the 1920s? Does anybody think he was a bad person for appearing in blackface in 1925? No, he was doing what was considered to be a norm, and that's just the way it is. We change, but we don't. We hurt ourselves if we go back and try to make judgments on people behaving 100 years ago in a different society. So anyway, he did that. And many people saw blackface as wailing and crying. I mean, that's what it was. And even Bob Dylan said, Al Jolson is somebody who I can feel. Jolson had a hand in many of the lyrics for the songs that he wrote. You okay over there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That he wrote. The song called California, Here I Come. Me and my shadow, back in your own backyard. He has lyric writing credit on all of those songs. It is probably apocryphal that he wrote those songs. He probably said, you want me to sing that song? You give me a piece of the action on that song with ASCAP. So he got his name on those songs. So maybe we can say Al Jolson was a great singer, a great performer, and not a bad businessman. And that's the way it was. He was one of the most avid supporters of our troops in the world. He was the very first American entertainer to go to the troops after Pearl Harbor in 1941. Maybe by that time it was 1942. He was the first American performer to go to Korea when the Korean War started. But here's what it cost him. He went to Korea in 1950. On those days, 50, he would take a ship, right? So he was going back to New York where he lived. He took a long ship across the Pacific, got to San Francisco, and he was going to stay there for a few days before he then took the train across the United States of America. So he was staying at the Fairmont Hotel, having just come back from a long USO tour. I don't know if they had USO on the USO, whatever, and the troops in Korea. Long, long voyage across the Pacific Ocean. And they were staying, he and his entourage, at the Fairmont Hotel. He had accumulated a lot of dirt and dust on the Korean gig that he did. It settled in his lungs. He was playing cards, and all of a sudden he was feeling faint. He said, I'm going, boys. And he died right on the spot in the Fairmont Hotel. He was 64 years old. Al Jolson defies description as a singer. He's just so unique, so spectacular. And I think you'll like this song. Rock-a-bye your baby to a Dixie melody. When you croon, croon a tune from the heart of Dixie. Just place my cradle mammy mind right on the Mason-Dixon line and swing it from Virginia to Tennessee with all the love that's in you. I know somebody that lives in Tennessee. He's in this very room. So I think you'll like this. I'm not going to read all of the lyrics to you. Notice that Al Jolson has a very powerful voice, a very distinctive voice. Nobody can ever sound like Al Jolson. And he's got a lot of soul, a lot of feeling, a lot of power. One of the lyrics in this song that he sings the second time through is Old Black Joe, another song which might be censored today. That was written by Stephen Foster 160 years ago, and the second time he will sing Old Black Joe rather than Soft and Low. There are two lyrics on that. Stephen Foster wrote Old Black Joe in 1853. So here we go with our second song. This is the great Al Jolson and a lullaby that you all know but maybe haven't heard for a while. This was what he sang and how he sang it at the Winter Garden Theater in 1925. This is Rockabye Your Baby to a Dixie Melody.
Rockabye your baby with a Dixie melody. When you croon a tune from the heart of Dixie. Hang that cradle, Mammy Mine, right on that Mason-Dixon line, and swing it from Virginia to Tennessee with all the soul that's in you. Weep no more, my lady. Mammy, sing it again for me. And old Black Joe, just as though you have me on your knee. A million baby kisses I'll deliver if you will only sing the Swanee River. Rock-a-bye, you'll rock-a-bye, baby, with a Dixie melody. Rock-a-bye, hush-a-bye, with a Dixie melody. When you croon a tune from the heart of Dixie. Hang that cradle, Mammy Mine, right on that Mason-Dixon line, and swing it from Virginia to Tennessee with all of the soul that's in you. Mammy, Mammy, listen what they're playing. They're playing Weep No More, My Lady. Sing it for me and old Black Joe. Just as low, you had me on your knee. A million baby kisses I'll deliver if you will only sing the Swanee River. Rock-a-bye, you'll rock-a-bye, baby, with a Dixie melody.
Yeah. Alex Olson. A.C. Olson. We all love many of the same songs. I was to say there are probably hundreds of songs that I love and you love. But also, each of us probably has a little bit of a repertoire of songs that a lot of people may not love, may not know as well, maybe obscure, that happen to be important in our lives that are not shared universally, right? So we all, you know, we love I'll Be Loving You Always. We all love that song. But we all have our own. And I got a lot of those in my life. And I'm going to play one for you now that you may or may not know, but I think you will like it in any event. It's interesting to me about this, and this song was a big hit in the 1950s for a wonderful singer, and it's a pretty relatively obscure song. It'll be interesting to see how many of you know it. You probably do. But I remember once there was a wonderful piano player named Ramon Belve who played at a restaurant called the Prime Rib in Washington, D.C. I loved this guy, since retired. I loved him. Every time we went to Washington, we went there, we talked, and we got to know him. There's nothing better than a wonderful piano player. Nothing worse than a piano player is not wonderful, by the way. That's how I feel. So Raymond began to understand that I love the great American, love this music. So as soon as a piano player knows, you know, a couple of songs, what does he want to do? He wants to play a song you don't know, right? He wants to get you. I mean, this is like a game that we all play, you know? So what does he do? He plays this song. He plays the song I'm about to play. You'll know in a minute. So I said, oh, I know that room. I gave him the name. Okay, that's it. I give up. So of all this, and then it was so interesting because 6 months later, we're back in the restaurant. I see Ramon. We sort of email him, tell him we're going to be there to make sure he wasn't going to be off. And I said, play that song. And he's like, I can't remember. So he conjured it up one time to try to get me. But they can get me real fast, but he didn't that time. But in any event, this song was written by a guy named Mac Gordon. Like Harry Warren, one of the greatest songwriters you never heard of. Mac Gordon was born, his name was Morris Dibbleman, and he was born in Warsaw, Poland in 1904, died in New York City not many years later in 1959. Now, why haven't you heard of him? I will tell you. If you wrote for Broadway, it was, you know, the gay divorce by Cole Porter. So your name was above the title, so you can become famous. So if you were George Gershwin or Richard Rodgers or Harold Arlen, or Irving Berlin, and you had these big hits in New York City, your name was above the title, that's how you became famous. There was a whole other group of writers, and many people from New York came out here to do that, who were writing for Hollywood movies. They were great. Hollywood movies. Three pillars of the great American song. Write Hollywood movies, Broadway, and Tin Pan Alley. Hollywood came, all the great songs, all the Fred Astaire songs from Hollywood. Well, those guys were not famous. They were writers for hire. They were literally writers for hire. So that Mac Gordon would be working for Paramount or MGM or Warner Brothers or Columbia. And they'd be sitting there. And they would be doing this movie. And they'd say, gee, we need a song here where the lady's brokenhearted because the guy just left. So they call Mac, you got to write a song about a guy who's brokenhearted because the girl just left. And he'd come up with this song. And it became a big hit in the movie. But nobody knew, except way at the end credits, that this guy had written the music. He wrote music, this did Mac Gordon, for 90 films. 90 films. And some of the songs he wrote were Chattanooga Choo Choo. That was, I Got a Gal in Kalamazoo. Bells, I Had the Craziest Dream Last Night. I Had the Craziest Dream, that one. You'll Never Know. You'll Never Know Just How Much I Love. He got 9 nominations for Academy Awards and won one of them, and that was for You'll Never Know. And then a wonderful song called I Can't Begin to Tell You How Much You Mean to Me. You know that one? He wrote all of these songs, but you never hear much about him. But he's worthy of your attention. 90 movies, 9 Oscar nominations. This song called This Is the Beginning of the End. How many people know that song? Oh my goodness. Well, you're going to... Okay, well, I get to share something new with you. This Is the Beginning of the End was written in 19... It was written for a movie in 1941. And it became a hit in the hands of a guy named Don Cornell 10 years later in 1951. It was not a hit. In 1941, when the song was first in the movie called Johnny Apollo, the name of the movie was Johnny Apollo, with Tyrone Power and Dorothy L'Amour, the song was in there. It was a good song. It was a damn good song. So Frank Sinatra and Tommy Dorsey recorded the song because they were together at that time. Well, it turns out that was not a big hit. It was no big deal. They recorded a song. It wasn't a big hit. And then a decade later, Don Cornell dusted this song off, and it became a smash hit. Now, Dorothy L'Amour, who sang this song in the movie, introduced a lot of Mac Gordon hits in movies. I Remember You, You're the One, that one, she sang that. It Could Happen to You, Hide Your Heart from Sight, Lock Your Dreams at Night. But Beautiful, that one. And The Moon of Manacora. You know the song, The Moon of Manacora, where Dorothy L'Amour is a beautiful girl in a sarong against a palm tree singing this really, really sultry, sexy, wonderful song. Later, she became to do more sedate songs. And somebody said, why are you doing that? Why aren't you singing these sexy, sultry, sassy songs you used to sing? And she said, at my age, you can't lean against a swaying palm tree and sing Moon of Manacora anymore. And she knew she had to move on. Anyway, she recorded this song first in the movie. Don Cornell, who sang it, was actually born in the Bronx. His name was Luigi Francisco Valero. Now, an interesting thing is happening tonight, right? A lot of the people who wrote these Muse songs were Jewish. but a lot of people who sang these songs were Italian. A preponderance of people who sang these songs were Italian, like Don Cornell changed his name, Bobby Darin changed his name, Vic Damone changed his name. But he started in the Bronx. He was born in the Bronx 20 years before Bobby Darin was born in the Bronx. So we have two good singers came out of there. And by the time he was very young, he was singing with the Red Nichols little group. And then Sammy Kay, Swing and Sway with Sammy Kay, was riding along in Detroit, Michigan, and he heard a live remote from the Pelham Bay Inn in Yonkers. And Don Cornell was singing with Red Nichols, and he said, I need a big band singer, I'm going to get that guy. 2 weeks later, Don Cornell was singing for Sammy Kay, Swing and Sway with Sammy Kay. And he did that for almost 10 years. And by the way, it's interesting that all these bands had monikers, right? So I'm going to give you some monikers and see if you can figure out who was. Swing and Sway with Sammy Kay, right? Who was the sweetest music this side of heaven? Nope. Big band. Guy Lombardo. Champagne music. Lawrence Welk. You got that one. See what television will do for you? The Band of Renown.
Les Brown.
Yes, sir. And one more. The Sentimental Gentleman of Swing.
Tommy Dorsey.
Who said that? Yes, sir. Tommy Dorsey, the Sentimental Gentleman of Swing. In 1949, he went solo, and he had 12 gold records, including It Isn't Fair, I'll Walk Alone, and I'm Yours. And then when rock and roll came in, a lot of these singers gave up. They moved on. They went somewhere else. But Don Cornell kept at it, and he worked and worked until the 90s. And then he died, and his wife, Iris, tried to keep it alive. So he kept going and kept going, kept traveling, kept moving, and all that kind of thing. He worked hard to do it. There was an interesting thing. He had a song called I'm Yours, okay? Now, I'm Yours was the last song he did with Sammy Kay. It was 1949. He was about to go on his own. So Sammy Kay had to be a good guy because he wanted to help Don Cornell. In those days, the singer was subservient, subordinate to the band, right? So if you had a record in those days, even Frank Sinatra and Tommy Dorsey, it was the Sentimental Swing, Tommy Dorsey Orchestra, vocal refrain by Frank Sinatra. That's how it worked, even if you were Frank Sinatra in those days, because the big band was promised, band era, right? It was a big, Glenn Miller. So that the singer just wasn't important as the band. When they did It Isn't Fair, which was a massive hit, Sammy Kay wanted to give Don Cornell a shove out the door into his solo career, wanted to help him. So instead of saying It Isn't Fair, Sammy Kay and his orchestra, vocal refrain by Don Cornell, he said Don Cornell, backed up by the Sammy Kay Orchestra. I'll never forget that. It was such a sweet thing to do, and it worked. Well, maybe not only that worked, because Cornell was a great singer, as you'll soon hear, but he was just nice enough to give him some prominence so he could go off on his own. And he did, and he worked for a long time. Had to set up his own record label in later years because that kind of music wasn't getting any record contracts. He had one song called I, right? Now, here's your trivia moment at the moment. It was 1952. It was the only one-character song in the history of the pop charts until that moment. And then the second one was a song called Seven by Prince in 1992. so that was a little bit of trivia for you there. One of the things that we know today, like the back of our hand, but we didn't always know this, is the overwhelming, transcendent power of television to persuade. It's changing a little bit today because of the fragmentation of media. But there was a time, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 10s, where television was more important far and away than newspapers and magazines and radio and billboards and all of it, all combined. No doubt about that. So if you went to a presidential campaign 20 years ago, 85-90% of the budget would go to television advertising. That's the way it was. That's obviously dissipating now to a certain extent, but still, it's powerful. He was one of the first people to learn that, because he would go out with Sammy Kay, and then one night, 1,000 people, and another night, 1,000 people, and another 1,000. It's not many people, right? Then, all of a sudden, he goes on the Ed Sullivan Show, And the phone is ringing off the hook the next day, because in one night, in one three-minute appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show, he could reach 30 million people, and all of a sudden people wanted to make records, they wanted to get club dates, they wanted to book him. And then he went on Milton Berle the next month, and he really was one of the first to understand the overwhelming power of television. Don Cornell, by way of some trivia for you, had one great folly. In 1959, there was an oil man named Tom Young. He was looking for investors in something he called the Big Daddy Mining Company. Now, if it's called the Big Daddy Mining Company, I'd probably give you a clue that maybe you don't want to put your money there. You know, it just doesn't feel right to me. Maybe Exxon seems a little better. He said he had this rich vein of oil 60 miles east of Fresno. He got three investors. Three. A dentist from Fresno, Martha Ray, of all people, and Don Cornell. The thing was, they couldn't fill up a thimble with the amount of oil he got out of that. But other than that, everything was okay. Let me see. Do I have any? I want to make sure I didn't miss anything, because I love this part here. Okay, I didn't miss anything. So this is the beginning of the end. Don Cornell is Bel Canto. He has a wonderful voice. He doesn't swing. Very Italianate kind of singer. It's about change, right? You know, there's certain themes that we have: losing love, getting love, wanting love. Those are the basic things. Well, one of the things, there's a "you've changed." It's just that, right? Billy Holiday had a big hit with "You've Changed." So that the concept of putting into music the idea that you're in love and you got this relationship, but you can see that something's changing, right? You can see it, you can feel it. We've all had that, right? Anybody here not get dumped once at least? You of course you have. So you can see it going like that, and that's what this song is about. This is the beginning of the end. I can see it in your eyes and everything you do. Though you're afraid to tell me that we're through, I can tell by looking at you. And it goes on from there. And he kind of spits this thing out. You know, he seems a little angry about this, and who can blame him? I've told you before how I'm fascinated by the tactile sense of music. So when he sings, "This is the beginning of the end," you will feel, not hear, but you will feel a suspension. And you will know that it has to come down. It just has to. You're not going to be comfortable if he stays up there and then it lets go. And you can feel the release. I can see it in your, "This is the beginning of the end." Feel yourself up here, elevated, knowing that you've got to get off there. And then he says this, and I can see it in your eyes, and you'll feel that everything is okay. When later on, when he sings, "This is the beginning of the end, I can see the thrill is gone, but I let it linger on." At that point, he becomes a little bit defiant. You can see that he's saying, you know, okay, let's get on with it. You don't love me anymore, so let's press on with it. So I think you will like this song. This was at the very center. I could talk about this a lot, but it really, somebody has to talk about it, because nobody is. There's an amazing, almost unforgotten period of music between the end of the big band era and the beginning of rock and roll, 5 or 6 or 7 years. And this was one of the most amazing periods in popular music in this country. And yet, because of the big band era and the rock era bracketing this short period of time, it is largely forgotten. But you had the vocal groups, you had the male singers, you had the female singers, you had what was left of the big band. It was amazing. And Don Cornell was absolutely right in the middle of it. And you're going to like this, I think. So, nobody raised their hand when I said you know this song, so I hope that I have had the ability to introduce you to something new. Don Cornell, massive hit, 1951. This is the beginning of the end. Cold opening, suspension, and then release. And this is backed up by a studio orchestra.
This is the beginning of the end. I can see it in your eyes, in everything you do. Oh, you're afraid to tell me that we're through. But I can tell by looking at you. This is the beginning of the end. You just give yourself away with everything you say. And though you never told me we must part, still I can read the writing on your heart. Why is it now, when I hold your hand, there's some little something that I miss? And what has become of the warmth in your smile? And where's that little mischief in your goodnight kiss? This is the beginning of the end. I can see the thrill is gone. Why let it linger on? Why lie to me and say it isn't so? For when I hold you in my arms, I know that this is the beginning of the end. Why is it now, when I hold your hand, there's some little something that I miss? And what has become of the warmth in your smile? And where's that little mischief in your goodnight kiss? Oh, this is the beginning of the end. I can see the thrill is gone. Why let it linger on? Why lie to me and say it isn't so? For when I hold you in my arms, I know that this is the beginning of the end.
Don Cornell. For the record, I am incapable of expressing to you how important that song is to me, among many others. I have one more song to play for you tonight. Thank you for coming. Let me tell you that I have two lectures this summer, which is uncharacteristic. I usually don't lecture in the summer, but the library asked me if I would, to which I replied, yes. So I'm doing June 14th on Zoom. That's fun too, because I'm getting people from all over the country, and even some from Europe if they wake up early enough. And then August 9th in this very room, so it's summertime, summertime, Jamie and the James. So if you're around on June 14th, Zoom, we're going to send you information on this. August 9th, I hope to see you right back here. Well, I decided to close this evening with a spring song. I'm still going to do it, you know, because it is spring, right? The spring equinox came. Actually, the spring equinox came about 11:30 on Monday. Because we say when the spring. I'm very interested in astronomy in that sense, you know. And spring is like 1/10 of 1/1,000,000 of 1 second, right? I mean, it can only happen just like that, right? I mean, the sun has to be, like, in the equinox, it's moving. So it's just there's a 1/10 of a second when it's what it is, and then it's immediately moving to something else. So I try to take note of that when it happens, but anyway, it happened on Monday. So this is spring, and the calendar tells me that. So we're going to do a wonderful song by a wonderful man named Benny Goodman. This is another song which matters to me very, very much. Benny Goodman was the 9th of 12 children. Yeah. They were all Jewish people from Russia. And Benny Goodman, like a lot of first-generation immigrants in those days, was born, raised in a slum on the south side of Chicago, near railroad. Yeah, south side of Chicago. Big bad Leroy Brown was in south side of Chicago. They were in a railroad yard and factories, and it was a that's when America was really a melting pot, and immigrants, you know, really wanted to be Americans, and it was really, you know, it was the beginning of some wonderful things. So he was raised among Germans and Irish and Italians and Polish and Scandinavians and lots of Jews, and so he learned to live in that kind of a melting pot. But even though they were poor, like a lot of Jewish people in my observation, his father was quite cultured, and he used to take Benny Goodman to free concerts in Douglas Park when Benny was a little boy, and engendered in young Benjamin a love for music. And then later, when Benny showed a proclivity for music, he actually, his father, who was poor and had 12 kids to raise, paid for music lessons for Benny Goodman at the local synagogue. So much so that Benny Goodman got his first union card when he was only 13 years old, and began to perform on boat excursions on Lake Michigan. And by the way, at age 17, his father was killed stepping off a streetcar, and by the way, I remember when I was a little kid, I used to notice I was from Pittsburgh, right? And so we had streetcars, and it was always interesting to me that those streetcars let you off in the middle of the street, because no way you could make it along the curb, right? I mean, so you had to be really, really careful getting off of a streetcar. I'm sure that Betty's father wasn't the only one who met the face that way. Well, when he was a young kid in Chicago, Benny, at age 15, was working with Bix Beiderbecke. Now, you talk about consensus of the cognoscenti. I don't know about trumpet players, but everybody I know will say that Bix Beiderbecke was the greatest trumpet player who ever lived. That certainly included Louis Armstrong, who said, ain't anybody played like him before. That's how what Louis said. And then, that was an interesting thing to me, because this was in 1922. And by 1922, Louis Armstrong had left New Orleans and was living in Chicago. And Louis Armstrong's formative years were between about 1920 and 1930 in Chicago before he went to New York, where he stayed for the rest of his life. And I'm very interested in this, that Midwest jazz scene in the 20s, which was Chicago, Indianapolis, Kansas City, interests me very much. These people came up New Orleans, right? They stopped there and then went on to New York. And it was a very big deal. Bix Beiderbecke was there. Jack Teagarden was there. Benny Goodman was there. Louis Armstrong was there. Fletcher Henderson was there. They were all there, and big things were happening. It just really interests me what it must have been like in the 20s. In Indianapolis, for example. And Detroit, you know, Gannett Records was in Detroit, Michigan in those days. And then Benny finally did move to New York, where he did a lot of studio work, and that's when he did studio work with Glenn Miller, in the early 30s, right before the big band era really hit. Tommy Dorsey, Red Nichols, Isham Jones, they were all, you know, in these formative years. And then shortly after that, Benny formed his own band called the Benny Goodman Boys. And one of the people in that band was Glenn Miller, who actually wrote a song for that band called 1441. And by 1934, they were doing so well that Benny Goodman had a record deal with Columbia Records. And the rest was history. And one of the things that Benny Goodman did back in those days was he rotated a lot of people. He rotated his sidemen, and he rotated his singers. So he had Billie Holiday singing with him, Mildred Bailey singing with him, Jack Teagarden playing trombone with him, rotating all the time. And in 1934, late 1934, Benny actually already had his first number one record, which was Moonglow, way back then, which later became the theme for the movie Picnic in the early 1950s. That was way back from 34, so it was 20 years later. And then he did a radio show called Let's Dance, took off like a shot, because in those days, radio was like television was later in terms of promoting people and things. But Benny had a problem, because the big bands at the beginning were for dancing, right? It was a dance, they were called dance bands. Benny didn't mind if people danced to his music, but he was a swinger. He was swing. And a lot of people weren't ready for that. They wanted Guy Lombardo and Shep Fields and you know, what they called the sweet bands in those days. So Benny had some problems. At one point, Guy Lombardo was playing at the Roosevelt Hotel in New York. It's still there. And he got sick, and they had Benny Goodman's substitute for him. So people who came to the Roosevelt to hear Guy Lombardo were interested in sweet music, and then Benny comes in there and he knocks the roof off the place, and nobody liked it because they weren't used to it, because they wanted this sweet, you know, tranquil dance music of Guy Lombardo, the Royal Canadian. So he was a big failure. So he was like a fish out of water for a while. This is a guy who was about to invent swing, by the way, but at times, you know, when there's change, a lot of people don't like it. Well, he had a defining tour to the West Coast. Came out here in 1935. And he was, you know, playing stock arrangements because he didn't think people were ready for swing, so he was playing all these relatively bland arrangements, and it wasn't really going over well. So he didn't know what to do. He was playing at a place called the Palomar Ballroom in Los Angeles. I think it was on Vermont Avenue in those days, 1935. It wasn't working. He was playing all this, you know, sweet band music, and it wasn't working. He was dying. Gene Krupa was his drummer. And it was Gene who said, "Look, Benny, if we're going to die, let's at least die doing our own thing." So they put away all the sweet arrangements. They bring out Fletcher, Henneman, Schwartz, and they cooked. And they were a smash hit. And when you have a musical era, any kind of artistic era, you can't draw a bright line necessarily. But one could say that the swing era started on that night at the Palomar Ballroom in Los Angeles in 1935, that was the beginning. Because the swing era only lasted from 1935 to 1945. Now, obviously, it's not a bright line, but Benny, he certainly was a crystallizing force for that swing at the Palomar Ballroom, and that's, of course, long gone. They were very, very big hits. At that time, Benny was called the Raha of swing, or rhythm. Raha's rhythm. And a guy named Gene Krupa was called the King of Swing. But one night, somebody on the radio called Benny Goodman the King of Swing, and it stuck. So Krupa said, "Okay, I give up the moniker, you can have it." And he became the King of Swing. So Paul Wagman was the King of Jazz, that was in the 20s. Benny Goodman was the King of Swing in the 1930s. He played all of his life. He couldn't give it up. Somebody once said that Benny Goodman was going to be buried with that clarinet. For all I know, he was. He soldiered on. He did his last concert on June 13, 1986, 6 days before he died. He did 6 days after he did that concert. He lived in Westchester County in New York City, but he had an apartment in New York City on Central Park South. He took a nap in that apartment 6 days after that June 13th concert, had a heart attack, and died on the spot, but he soldiered right to the end. Benny Goodman, you know, I've already mentioned Mildred Bailey and Billie Holiday. He was one of the first people to integrate. When he had a trio, he had Teddy Wilson for his piano player. Teddy Wilson was black, so one-third of that trio was black. And then when he went to a quartet, he hired Lionel Hampton to be the vibe man, vibraphones, and so now half of that was black. This was 10 years before Jackie Robinson integrated baseball in the late 1940s. Then Benny Goodman, when asked about it, said, if a guy's got rhythm, let him give it. I'm selling music, not prejudice, which sums it all up. Okay, so I'm saying Benny Goodman was largely responsible for inventing swing, although I'm not saying it's a bright line. So what is swing? The answer is I don't know. But I know this. His daughter was listening to a chart that Benny Goodman was playing, a chart by Fletcher Henderson that Benny was playing with his group. She went to the music after the song was over. She was expecting to see 1,032,064 notes on that page, because it sounded like that. You know, just full with play, how they say it, the tiny slices of rhythm that tumble off the page. She was going to see all these notes, because that's what she heard. She goes on the page, and they're nothing but quarter notes, lulling and looking bored. So she said to Benny, her father, "That's not what I heard." And Benny said, "Of course not. Swing cannot be written. You got to play it, you got to make it happen, and you got to feel it." So when you try to define swing, Benny Goodman couldn't do it either, because he said, "You feel it. You know, it's 2/4 time, but it's really hard to define. But I know it when I hear it, and I hear it a lot, and I love hearing it a lot." Betty Goodman was born in 1990, died in 1986. He was famous for making people famous: Harry James, Teddy Wilson, Lionel Hampton, Bunny Berrigan, and of course Gene Krupa. A seminal moment was when Betty Goodman did the Carnegie Hall concert in 1938, and I want to talk a little bit about that, because in 1938 at Carnegie Hall in New York City, Betty Goodman brought jazz and swing into respectability. Prior to that time, the only music that had ever been played at Carnegie Hall was so-called classical music. They invited Benny Goodman in, and they said he was smuggling contraband into the halls of European high culture. January 16, 1938, 2,760 seats in Carnegie Hall, top price $2.75, complete sellout. Sold out so fast that they actually put extra seats on the stage, and they could get almost up to 2,900 seats. Benny was nervous. You have to understand, I mean, you understand that, right? I mean, he's going, Toscanini, he was nervous. I'm going to Carnegie Hall, where the European masters perform. What could I do? And somebody said, and he was so nervous, that he canceled 5 dates prior to the Carnegie Hall date so he could go there and test the acoustics and test the environment and get a feeling for the place. And at one point, somebody said to Benny, it'll be a two-act show, how much time do you want to take for intermission? And Benny said, how much does Toscanini take? So he just wanted to be like them. But he needn't have worried because it all worked. The concert itself started out quietly at first. He did what were standards at the time for him, 1 o'clock jump, don't be that way. And it started to build a little bit, but it was still a little bit restrained. And then he brings in two guest stars, Duke Ellington and Count Basie. How bad is that? And then it builds from there, right? Then he brings in Martha Tilden to sing the classic song, And the Angels Sang. Brought down the house. So much so that they did not have a second song for Martha Tilden, and they had to improvise one. So she got an encore, which improvised, I don't know what it was. And then the finale was, of course, Sing, 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 right? The great Sing, Sing, Sing. And I often wonder, you know, you hear that song today, you hear any big band concert today, to the extent that there are any left. And what do they close with? They sing, sing, sing. I mean, it's what happens. That's what they, and I try to imagine, what was it like to hear that song in Carnegie Hall for the first time in 1938? I can't even imagine it. I can't even imagine what it was like to be introduced to this by Benny Goodman and Gene Krupa in 1938. Interestingly enough, the recording of that concert was made, released, and then lost for many, many years. And then Benny's sister, in 1950, found the original master tape for that concert in Benny's house in Westchester. It was there all the time, and it was then re-recorded again. In 1998, and it's been available ever since. Benny, I should tell you, on a personal basis, was very controversial. He was not a nice man. He was a cheap person. He was not benevolent with his people. He was demanding, and rather than being, you know, empathetic, if they messed up, he had something called the ray. He would stare at people without saying anything, and they called it the ray, the Benny Goodman ray, which was, you got that ray, and you just wanted to crawl into a hole. The great Helen Forrest was a big band singer for Benny Goodman, the great, great Helen Forrest. She was there for 20 months, and she said, being with Benny for 20 months felt to me like 20 years. She just hated being there. So, you know, he was respected and loved because he worked harder than anybody else, and he practiced more than anybody else, but he was demanding and I would say unsympathetic, but so, you know, a lot of artists might be. This song you're about to hear is really important to me. It's from an album called Swing into Spring, which I thought was appropriate because this is the second day of spring. In 1958, and I saw this show, there was a show on TV called Swing into Spring. It was Benny Goodman. It was sponsored by Texaco. And they made an album of Swing into Spring, which was not available in stores. You could go to Texaco gas station, fill up your car, and you could get this for a dollar. I didn't bring it, but I have my original album of Swing into Spring. I own it, I love it, I cherish it. And that was in April, of 1958. And it was just a wonderful show. You know, it was springtime, and you could feel happiness and all the wonderful ideas that go along with spring. And there was Benny Goodman doing this contemporary play, I'll Never Say Never in Love Again, and Undecided, Just You, Just Me. And then the big finish was this song you're about to hear, Swing into Spring. You probably never heard this, but I love this song so much I love it so much that because it's now 2023, I'm kind of sad about it. I can't, don't ask me to explain, but it just makes me sad in some ways. Maybe it's the passage of time, I don't know. You're going to hear a trumpet solo in this song. That trumpet is Doc Severinsen, who at age 90-something is still alive and well and kicking and playing a mean trumpet. You're going to hear Benny open this song with his licorice stick, the clarinet, and then there's a double punch here. I'm going to go like this. It's a double punch. You're going to hear that. I love punches, you know, staccato thing. And then you're going to hear Benny do the melody on the clarinet. And then you're going to hear a solo by Benny off the melody, and then Benny another solo, and then a trumpet solo by Doc Severinsen, and then a piano solo by Teddy Wilson, and then a big finish. So this is not a song that has any words to it, but you can feel it's about spring, you can feel it's about swing, you can feel it's about really getting into the groove of music, and the melody is so infectious that I think even though you haven't heard it, you can like it the very first time through. So I'm going to leave you with this. This is the great Benny Goodman, a television show that I remember seeing as a little child. Well, not that little, but I was little. And I'm happy to leave you with this, the great Swing into Spring. And if you want to know what swing is, you want to know what swing is, right? I wasn't able to tell you?
Yeah.
The best thing to define something is to point to it, right? So this is swing. You're going to hear swing right now. The best of swing. Here we go. Thank you, everybody.